we all need to stand for water. We all need to stand for this earth. We all need to stand for this air. We all need to stand for one another. We're losing so much. Like I said, in 70 years, I remember going down to the river and drinking that blue, crystal, greenish, cool, sweet water. And it just hurt my heart. At that time, I was like 15, 16. And the following year, they put up a plant, a sewage plant. They said it'd be good for all. It killed everything on the river. And this is another thing that is going to kill what we know as life. There is no more water. We waste. We waste. We waste. We waste the air. We waste the water. We waste the land.
Santiam Kalapuya people who are right here, we're still here, Santiam. So on behalf of them, you know, I don't speak for the tribe formally for the government, but I do speak for our family, and I can tell you that, you know, welcome here and thank you for what you guys are doing, and Santiam Kalapuyas are happy to have you. And Kanaway in Saiga, Itilikum in Saiga, in our language we say we are all one family. Kanaway and Saiga, Iktilikum and Saiga. We are all one family. And today, we're all here with Ik Dum Dum, with one heart. And we're here to give thanks for T'uk Damanawas. In our language, we say T'uk Damanawas, the water spirit. Water is so important. And for my family, the way that Uncle taught us, I haven't seen you in a long time, brother, by the way. I love you very much. I supported you, and I didn't even get a chance to say hi to you. But in my family, we sat in a lot of ceremonies with our uncle before he passed. And I can tell you right now, the first prayer that came out of that man's mouth often was thanking for the water. Thank you for the water. Hi, Umasi, Kabatuk Damanawas. Thank you. Hi, Umasi. Sahali Tai, Kabasak Damanawas. Thank you, Creator, for the water. Without the water, we're nothing. It all starts with water. All starts with water. So you guys are awesome for being here today and for causing more attention to this and for the community, for bringing the community together.
Going on right now. What is going on right now is a daily prayer every day. There's a daily prayer where the protectors are walking towards a designated area that they're going to go pray for. And each day that they're walking to do this prayer in a peaceful way, we have prayer people, people with drums, pipes, walking, leading the way, as our drummers were leading the way right now with this flag in their prayer. While they're walking towards this place where they're going to stop and do their prayer, there's nothing but military personnel standing there waiting, greeting them with semi-automatic loaded weapons. And behind them, if you're looking at the news right now with a Mosul and Iraq war, those tanks behind there are the same tanks that they're using on our protectors over there in Standing Rock. So I ask, you know, I kind of wonder, what are they doing? Why are they calling in over 100 personnel, military, over there? What are they doing? Are they parading? Are they waiting or what? They're waiting, or are they going to wait for a massive arrest? So we ask ourselves, why? For what? That's what's going on right now as they're walking. So we are at a flashpoint right now, meaning that they're getting closer. They are 6 miles away. And September 3rd, we were over there. We went over there. We were honored to go over there. Dino Butler, Confederate tribe, a Siletz Indian elder, and our family with our daughter taking us there to put the flag up there and to go there in a peaceful way. The day that we got there is when the military, it wasn't military, it was GS4, who had their dogs attack the people. What they were doing is they were stopping a burial site that they were desecrating over there. So we asked, why are they, what's going on here? So Obama administration, Corps of Engineers, stopped the pipeline construction 20 miles west of the other site. They stopped the construction under the water, but they did not stop the construction of where they are right now. 6 miles away is where the burial site was. Right behind that is where the big camp is. So we're wondering why, what's going on? How can they do that? So whose land is this? It was a farmer's land. The corporation went in and bought this land from this farmer, knowing that the land had burial sites on it. There was a report given way back, which was ignored from the Corps of Engineers, that there was a known burial site there. So again, here they are, 6 miles away from the burial site. They're going to have, they're keep on going, because legally, they're not supposed to do this. But we all know that we live in a colonial court system. And yes, it's against North Dakota protection law that they're not supposed to go through sacred sites. What did they do? They sent their state protection officer out there to see if this is true or not. And what did he say? He said there was nothing there that they could go ahead and proceed construction. And so that's why they're going. So, okay. So then the attorney general said, wait a minute. It's against state law for corporations to come in here and buy that big of a size of land to do what you're doing. It's agricultural land. But it's tied up right now. The legal is doing everything they can, but they're not moving fast enough because those machineries are going as we're talking now. And the snake keeps going. So what we're asking right now is for prayers. We're not asking for violent confrontations or anything like that. There has been 145 arrests already since this started. Last week there was 29 arrests on public land. And what they're saying is that they're rioting. And that's the new language that they're using right now. If you're on public land, you cannot demonstrate. You're not supposed to do certain things if there's certain officials around. So they're planning these different officials around where people are praying, and they're calling it rioting. So that's where we're at right now on the legal.
I went to Standing Rock last month and made a big supply run. Thank you. this really important work that's happening right now. We managed to take a really large truck. I got the health clinic for my tribe involved. We took medicines, toothpaste, hygiene products, a pallet of wool blankets. And then once we got there, elders from our tribe had given us money and stuff so that we were able to actually buy them building supplies and things that they needed right there. So it was really, really rewarding. And the thing that I would ask today is challenge each and every one of you to do something. This is something right here, just making the situation known and standing and getting behind it is something. Because not everybody can answer Creator's call to travel and go there and be boots on the ground, but there are definite ways that you can contribute in other forms. And I'd like to echo what the elder said before we started. Don't buy just any t-shirt you see online, because they're not going to the Standing Rock Sioux. The proceeds, these are people just trying to make a profit off of our backs. And that's been done to natives for long enough. I posted a list of sites and places where you can go and donate specific things in the Facebook event for this rally today. And those were gotten from the sisters at Standing Rock. Those are things that go directly to them. These people are very, very well organized. These relatives are, they've got it going on right now. They have a space for you to send native medicines to, and they will get those, and then they distribute them out to the seven camps that are there. Same thing with funding. And money is really what's needed now, because now they're having to winterize and build shelters that will, you know, protect them from 30 below winds, because that's what we're looking at now if they're going to winter over. There's so many things. I mean, I've wept several times when I reflect on my experience there and just how much love there is there. It's amazing to go someplace and see people from 300 different nations there, and to see an avenue of flags that stretches for as far as you can see. It can't even be contained in one photograph anymore. When I got there, they asked us to come in, and they introduced us to the council fire and the elders that were in there. That was really awesome, because the Great Sioux Nation is once again the Great Sioux Nation. The seven bands of the Sioux Nation have not sat at the same table and been of one mind and single-minded purpose in over 150 years. And that council of chiefs is seated again. And those people are all united again for one purpose. And there's a lot of people who have widely acknowledged that there's never been a movement like this. There's never been a time when all natives were united behind a single purpose. And we are now. And it's incredibly rewarding to see that and feel that and be a part of that. And besides that having, you know, greater implications for all of us, because it has to do with treaty rights for all of us. There's not a single treaty that the United States has ever honored. None. Treaty abrogation has been the word of the day and the order of business forever. And this is a situation to where the Standing Rock Sioux are taking control of their narrative and saying, look, you need to consult us about things like this. The Missouri River serves 18 million people water. This country's infrastructure is not even built to handle the sudden and immediate loss of 18 million people's drinking water. It's not something that we could deal with as a country. And an oil spill or an oil catastrophe is never a question of if, but when. There's not a single energy company that's managed to operate without having an accident of some kind. So the Standing Rock Sioux need all of the help that we can give them. Besides those implications, another really wonderful thing that's come out of this is, 7-8 months from now, there's going to be a whole bunch of Standing Rock babies. which is going to further the cause of Native people, because, you know, I mean, what do Natives do when it's cold in winter and you've got teepees? We made babies, so that's awesome. And the first baby was just born earlier this week at Standing Rock, just a few days ago. That's one of the really important things to also recognize about this, is that this whole movement started with some tribal youth and women. This entire thing, the whole movement, started with a bunch of tribal youth who knew what was happening and they wanted to protest it, and an elder gave them permission to camp on her land, and women, and then, you know, the mothers and the aunties all came in and said, oh, how can we support you? You know, let's support you and get this going. And so that this has turned into what it is now. A camp with 7 sub-camps serving anywhere from 3,000 to 5,000 people every day. It's amazing and awe-inspiring. The baby was born in the birth camp. There's a women's camp that's specifically set up for women's issues, for women who are about to give birth, for women who are pregnant, for women who are on their moon. They're having women-only sweats. It's really awesome. And there's a two-spirit camp that's been set aside. There's the Red Warrior Camp. The Red Warrior Camp is amazing. It's a natives-only camp. They have a powwow there every night. I can't tell you how awesome it was to fall asleep on the plains every night listening to drums until midnight or beyond. And then these same folks would get right back up again at 6 or 7 in the morning and grab some coffee and start singing and drumming again. It's amazing. So if you have a chance, if you can do anything, check out the list of sites or the list of things that they need. They've got a school there now because they're actually educating the kids right there. Because, you know, some parents wanted to be there, they heard Creator's call and they brought their kids. So now they're in a school. There's an actual school every day. So they need school supplies and things like that. They need stuff to winter over. I think one of the most important things to know is just if you can in any way help them financially, that's another big area. There's another cool thing that's happening, prayer walks every day at noon. The burial site that was gashed open by Dakota Access, they did that way inside the boundary, and that was one of the first things they did. When I was headed there, there were trucks passing us, one right after another. It's almost as if they're in a rush to get it done so that it can't be reversed. And each one of those trucks had like 15 huge green pipes on it. And I didn't realize until we got there that that was the actual pipeline pipe. Like, that's what they were dropping off. So, put pressure on your representatives. Call people in Congress. Call whitehouse.gov. Write whitehouse.gov. If enough people make a stink, there are petitions. I don't know if it, you know, it's maybe not widely known. I don't know if it's widely known. But if you get 150,000 people to sign a whitehouse.gov petition, it automatically gets the president's attention. Anything that gets 150,000 signatures automatically goes to the president's desk, where he will see it. So if each of us here today did that, and each of you put that out on your Facebook, you see how exponentially we could get to 150,000 signatures really fast. Like, it would only take a couple days. So that's something else I would encourage you to do when you go home. Go to whitehouse.gov. Look for the petition for Standing Rock and sign it.
Thank you. Yeah.
We're learning now, and I think that some of the things that we're learning, and this was expressed in the City Council's resolution, is that you know, there is just one water. When you destroy the water in one area, you're destroying the water for everybody. And we're learning that there's just one climate. And Native people are on the forefront of saying that this is, you know, the atmosphere belongs to all of us and that we cannot destroy it. So
I'll read the resolution from the council, and I say we could not have passed this resolution without students from OSU and community members showing up at the council meeting and saying we really need this and we want it. And so I'm glad of those people who showed up to support us in it. The City Council resolution on solidarity with Indigenous resistance to the Dakota Access Pipeline. Whereas the proposed Dakota Access Pipeline is a 1,168-mile pipeline being developed by Energy Transfer Partners and its affiliates, which would carry as much as 500,000 barrels per day of crude oil from North Dakota to Illinois, running beneath or across more than 200 streams and rivers, including the Missouri River. Whereas the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples affirms that Indigenous peoples have the right to protect their culture, religion, practices, and relationships with their traditionally owned or otherwise occupied and used lands and territories and waters. Whereas the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe has brought a lawsuit to halt construction of the pipeline for compelling reasons. The pipeline would pass under the Missouri River at Lake Owyhee, just a half mile upstream of the tribe's reservation boundaries, where a spill would be culturally and economically catastrophic, and the pipeline would pass through areas of cultural significance, such as sacred sites and burial grounds that federal law seeks to protect. Whereas the federal government's September 9th, 2016 suspension of construction appears to signal a broader willingness to re-examine the involvement of the tribes in infrastructure decisions like this one, according to the New York Times. Whereas communities of color are disproportionately impacted by environmental degradation, and the Dakota Access Pipeline project represents a continuation of the systematic oppression facing Indigenous peoples in the Americas that will set judicial precedences for future encounters between these nations. Whereas the City of Corvallis Council has a history of recognizing and acting for social and ecological justice, such as its resolution to divest from fossil fuels, to promote carbon pricing, the establishment of a September 22nd to 25th, 2016 as International Day of Peace, support of the Earth Charter, as well as its Climate Action Plan, which aims to significantly reduce greenhouse gas emissions and foster resilience to the effects of climate change. Whereas the City of Corvallis sits on land inhabited by the Kalapuya and Chinook people for over 8,000 years, and the state of Oregon is home to 9 federally recognized tribes. Whereas in 2015, Corvallis was the first city in Oregon to recognize Indigenous Peoples Day to be celebrated the second Monday in October. Whereas projects like the Dakota Access Pipeline are wholly inconsistent with the city's vision of a fossil-free economy and a worldview in large part shaped by Indigenous teachings based on reverence for the natural world, peace and justice for all sentient beings. And whereas the City of Corvallis values Indigenous culture's wisdom that clean water, air, and land is essential to life, and further investment in fossil fuel infrastructure poses an existential threat to the earth and all of its inhabitants. Therefore, be it resolved, the City Council of Corvallis stands in solidarity with the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe and its opposition to the Dakota Access Pipeline, with both moral support and a call to action by city residents following the lead of Indigenous groups, and urges municipalities, universities, and other organizations throughout the United States to do the same.
Presence. It means a lot for our efforts and the efforts of the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe and all of those who stand in solidarity from across the Americas for this purpose. Just like Councilman Mike said, this is not an incidence, it's a trend, and we're trying to show the mainstream society that we want this to end. It's going to set precedents for future decisions against treaty rights, against Indigenous peoples, against peoples of the non-mainstream society, so it's really, really important what we're doing here, and all of you are helping. Thank you. We want to say thank you so much to our speakers for coming out to join us and to bring everybody together. It's really, really encouraging to see the community coming together in this way. Ken is going to lead us with the drums in a final song, and then from there, we'll be continuing on in our lives, carrying on this mission in whatever way you personally can do so. Thank you.